Just recently, Your Excellency, you read a riot act warning those killing security personnel and burning critical national assets that they will be treated in a language they understand. That's a quoted statement. What do you really mean, Your Excellency?
Well, what I mean, how can you go to the police station, kill the police if they are there, loot the armory, and burn the place? What do you want to achieve? Go and open prison and allow criminals that have been tried through the legal system and let them loose on the society. And then how can government sit aside and allow this confusion to be perpetrated? All they need is confusion, and no government can allow confusion. Look at the NSAS incident in Lagos. The previous governor of Lagos State bought 200 buses to complement the transportation in Lagos. And he built a complex involving railways. But they went and burned them. The present governor made an album and came to see me. I said, thank you very much. I took the album, put it in my archives, and I told him to tell the Lagosians to walk, because we don't have the money. After an administration bought over 200 buses, some people to come and burn it, so let them walk.
So do you mean fire for fire?
More than that, we will arrest them. What I hope to arrest them, try them, give them very bad publicity, and then jail them, so that people will know that if they behave, they will not get away with it.
So in response to that, some Nigerians accuse you of playing what they call double standards, that insurgents, bandits, and kidnappers were never threatened in such a manner. How do you react to that?
They are being unfair. They should go and ask the governors of Sokoto, Zamfara, Katsina, and find out how we have been deploying the police and the military to deal with the bandits. We are not sparing anybody. But Nigeria is vast, and there are a lot of forests.
So it is a known fact that you hated these challenges of security from previous administrations. You have done so much towards finding lasting solutions. What have been your frustrations?
We are doing a lot. The problem is, if you order helicopters, you order a fighter aircraft, you order tanks, it takes time. We got armored vehicles from Jordan, from China, and these things, you have to take them to our institutions where they will be train the trainer. You get people, train them Nigerians, stock spare parts before you send them to operational area. These things take time, especially when you don't have much foreign exchange. But on a quiet way, if you can talk to some of your colleagues in the Air Force or in the Army, tell them where were they or where were we in 2015, where are we now? In terms of equipment, training, it's amazing. But no, we will never do well with those who want to oppose us. The Nigerian elite ought to give more time to what the effort the government is doing to physically secure the country, improve the economy, and stop corruption. And Nigeria did know that we campaigned both in 2015 and 2019 on security, because it's just common sense. You have to secure a country or an establishment to manage it properly. So number one thing is security. Number two, economy. Employment, a lot of youth that are unemployed. And then fighting corruption, making sure that the regulations we have on the ground followed to the letter. No shortcuts.
Recently, Your Excellency, arrests have been made in respect of those allegedly financing terrorism. What will you say is their motive, and how do you intend to deal with the situation?
Their motive is that they are made irrelevant, and they want to use their resources, the resources they accumulated over there, to prove that they are still around. And the administration will deal with them. Anybody could be dealt with.
Your Excellency, is there any hope that we will see an Nigeria that is free of security concerns before you leave office?
Well, this is my hope. This is what I'm working to. As I said, number one thing is security. If you don't secure the country, firstly, people will not invest. That was why those who organized ELSAS, I sent all the ministers back to their constituencies. Constitutionally, the ministers represent their states. I said they should go to their states. Let them speak to the governors. Let them speak to the political leaders. Let them speak to the traditional leaders. And very importantly, let them speak to the youth. That the federal government has no vacancy. Virtually every department is filled. The same thing in the states, the same thing in local governments. So you can have a good degree from a good university, and you will never get a job. Because if you promote insecurity by banning factories, by banning institutions, nobody will come and invest. So it's in their own interest to make sure that Nigeria is secure. When the country is secure, it's potentially rich. God has endowed Nigeria with resources. People will come and invest. But there must be security. There must be stability. Countries that have the resources to invest must make sure that they can recover their investment.
The fight against corruption is one of the cardinal pillars of your administration. How will you describe the journey so far, Your Excellency?
Well, under this system is difficult. I would like to repeat what I used to say. When I was, I think, a bit younger and in uniform when I came, I arrested President, Vice President, governors, ministers, commissioners, and put them under restriction or detention and told them that they are guilty until they can prove themselves innocent. Now, this is opposite the democratic system, as people would like to believe. And we put investigation panels virtually based on the present geopolitical zones for those who held positions. And because it was a law for people to declare their assets before when they become governors or ministers or commissioners or head of security agents, they were investigated. Those that cannot explain the extra resources they have in terms of assets and in the banks, they were asked to surrender it. It was taken from them. But eventually, I myself was arrested, detained, and they were given back their loot. So this is Nigeria.
You have once said that only God knows how much has been stolen from this country. But most worrisome, as you have also said, is that those with illegally acquired funds use them to fight your administration and destabilize the country. What have been the stumbling blocks in your efforts at making them pay for their sins?
Nigerians, I think, are very forgetful. I'm very pleased that the majority of Nigerians, which I believe, think that this country, this administration, under the circumstances, are doing their best. But, it's a capital but, people whom was appropriated funds, a lot of them were elected members, either at state level or at federal level. and their base still value them. You can accuse them or even try to prove that when they were elected members of the House of Reps and they were given ministries and so on, they had only one house and maybe a wife. But now there are several houses in Abuja, maybe in Lagos, and maybe two more wives. So really, if you try to work out their legitimate salary vis-a-vis their expenditures, they will be embarrassed. That's what I mean.
You have had cause to make a strong case for the establishment of specialized courts to fight corruption in this country. Do you believe that is still necessary?
Yes. To save time and to convince Nigerians we are serious. Because if you follow the legal system we inherited from our colonial masters, cases take 5-10 years, and people forget. But if you have sufficient courts, you develop terms of reference for them, you bring charges, immediately people are put before that court, they will come and defend themselves. But if you go through the system, especially if they still have some savings somewhere, they can get first-class sons, lawyers, to come and defend them. And the case will drag on until maybe either the judge dies or the committee got tired and they go back to their normal life. That's why I say sufficient courts are very important, especially in the cases of corruption, so that the Riot Act will be properly read to the public. That anybody who finds himself in a place of responsibility and misbehave, he will account for it. We shouldn't wait until people die and go before Almighty God.
Development of the railways is also a cardinal objective of your administration. You have done so much. Why do you focus on railways?
I used to sit and watch even the networking. 2 years ago also, if you watch and see the number of people dying between Lagos and Ibadan alone because of bad roads, because there are no railways, you will be sorry for this country. That was why I made up my mind that one of the priorities is to make sure that the roads and the rails are rehabilitated. And tell me, which country developed without infrastructure, roads, rail, and power? We have to get this correct. And those who are going about this country know that this administration has tried in terms of rehabilitating roads, in terms of rehabilitating the railway, in terms of increasing power. Relative to the resources and the time, we haven't done readily for those who want to be, who want to criticize us objectively.
So are you likely to see major cities of the country connected by rail?
Yes. We are planning that. We are planning that. And we are grateful to China Republic. They have agreed to help us, and they are helping us. And we are doing our best. And now we'll go and ask people that use trouble between even Lagos and Ibadan how much ease this development has brought to them. The trouble between Lagos and Ibadan used to be hell.
On the economy, Your Excellency, Nigeria recently exited its second recession due to the pragmatic implementation of your administration's economic policies and programs. Is it yet Uhuru? Are you satisfied with the performance of the economy so far?
No, I am not. That's why I'm trying even harder to make the people become accountable and to make sure we persuade foreign countries to allow their multinationals to develop more confidence in Nigeria and come and invest. When they develop more confidence in Nigeria, they will come and invest. That will give us employment, that will provide us with goods and services, and the chain, right from the farms upwards, you know, will be great, and that means a lot of employment. And this is our problem, large population, young population, unemployed population.
You promised to diversify the economy. How will you describe your efforts so far?
Well, you could recall, and if you don't, the business people and the smugglers will recall. We close the borders with Benin Republic and with Niger. With Niger, we have 1,500 kilometers border with them from Lake Chad to Benin Republic. And our business people that order things from Niger, but from Nigeria market. We close the borders, we soft importation of food. We know if you have to come through the port, you have a problem. One, we want the central bank that you are starting to anybody who is importing food. Let us eat what we produce. We make sure that you can only come through the port. Through the port, you pay customs. Before you go and buy other sterling, dollar, or whatever at the market, because central bank will let you give you money to go and import food. And when they come back, they cannot compete with local producers. So that encouraged a lot of people to go back to the land. There are people who left air conditioned office and went back to the farm. And that was positive for Nigeria. Now our own rice is fresh and is available and is competitive in the market. I think this is one of our major successes.
You're also doing so much in fertilizer production. Why fertilizer?
Yes, because we want productivity. And productivity means that people can get food, basically. And we have to empower the farmers. Fertilizer used to be very scarce, used to be very expensive. We made sure it's available in all local governments. And we try to sell it at subsidized prices so that ordinary farmers can afford fertilizer. And I'm telling you, we made a lot of progress. If we haven't taken that initiative, we have been in trouble. Why? Because, as I said, the petroleum industry has almost collapsed. We are not earning as much as we used to. And if we don't have the money to buy it, and we couldn't do farming, if we get 50 million people hungry, we'll be in trouble. So we made sure that we make it available, and the response was very, very good, as you know.
Let's talk politics now. Unlike other political leaders, you came out so early to announce that you are not going to stay a day longer after the termination of your administration. Why come out so early to announce that?
Well, I hate fraud in any form. If I haven't made the statement and made it absolutely clear that I have sworn to uphold the Constitution, and the Constitution said you can't do more than two terms, I have shown, I had the first term, and before the first term, I went to every local government in this country, all the 774 local governments. The second term, I went to every state, 2019. And I made a remarkable observation. The amount of people that came to see me in every state across the country were more than anybody can buy or force. So I'm very pleased that Nigerians deliberately made an attempt to understand me. And that I will stand by my oath of office that I will serve this country honestly and diligently.
In the last 7 months, Your Excellency, two PDP governors have defected to your party, the governing APC. Does that give you hope that the governing APC will return power in 2023?
Yes, we are preparing APC to remain in power for as long as possible. In the sense that we said registration of members from bottom to top, from fully unit to ward to local government to state to here in Abuja. We want to have a reliable number of people registered in APC in every state of the country. And we're going to give this a lot of publicity because the success of this administration will depend on the survival of APC after we left. It's no use that we leave and then we leave with the party. The party should continue.
You still have 2 years to go in the execution of your mandate. Describe for us the kind of Nigeria you'd like to hand over to your successor.
I would like to hand over a secure, prosperous, confident Nigeria to whoever succeeds me. This is very important because there are people, if not in Nigeria, outside, that are watching the development of developing countries, the systems we are going through. Look at what we went through from January 15, 1960 to now. Coups, counter coups, civil war, coup, counter coup. Then elections. We now go from elected government to elected government. Instead of elected government, coup, counter coup, elected government, coup, so. We are certainly down with a multi-party democratic system. And if that is honestly pursued and supervised by current administrations, it's the best thing. Allow people to choose which individuals and which party to run their affairs. It's very respectful to ordinary people. But if you make it a big man's party, only the rich and so on, then the security cannot be guaranteed.
In the last 6 years, Your Excellency, your administration has done so much to keep Nigeria united and provide the basic necessities of life. Looking back, sir, what would you say you are most happy about? What gives you joy?
I think no matter how reluctantly, majority of Nigerians are understanding me and appreciating the efforts we are making. Because that was the word, as I told you much earlier, we identify our problem. One, security. Two, economy, employment of people. And third, try to fight corruption. People getting something for nothing. You have to make sure that people earn their living and they will defend it.
Finally, sir, you have recently taken the second dose of your COVID-19 vaccine. How do you feel? Any side effect, Your Excellency?
Well, there are no side effects. I'm very pleased that I have got the second injection. But what I'm worried is wearing this Kakungumi, I call it.
Mr. President, I would like to sincerely thank you for this opportunity.
Thank you very much indeed.